Good evening, people of God. Welcome to Timothy Lutheran Church tonight, to our members, to family, to friends, as we gather here in this place, in this space, on this most holy night, to celebrate what Jesus did so many years ago, entering into our world. My name is Pastor Ryan. I'm one of the pastors here tonight, and it's always unusual preaching around this time on Christmas Eve because there's the guy up front for many of the kiddos that's standing between them and their gifts. So, you know, I'm sorry, but this will be a good time together. I pray the songs that we sing, the time that we have together, fills you with a sense of joy at what God has done and what God continues to do. If you brought me a gift, you can leave it under the tree on your way out tonight, and I will not open it until I'm done with my job this evening. For the rest of you, I do pray that the rest of your night is filled with joy, food, family, and maybe that enters into tomorrow. One other thing just to be aware of this evening is that we do have a Christmas Day service tomorrow. There's only one. It's at 10 a.m. right here in this same place. It'll be a different service, different sermon, different face up here. And so you're welcome to join us for that. We also have a 9 p.m. candlelight service, although we're going to be lighting our candles. Don't worry, tonight too. There's a candlelight service at 9, which will be different than this service too. So if you want to join us for that, you're welcome to join us for that also tonight. With that, what I'd like to invite you to do is, I know you probably know most people around you, but I encourage you just to give a quick greeting, Christmas greeting, to those around you this evening as we begin our time together. Just that chance to fellowship with those around us who are worshiping is just a brief time for us to give joy to the family of God. In the pew in front of you, or if you have the Timothy Lutheran app, we invite you to let us know you're here, that you can connect with us through this card. Let us know you're here to worship with us tonight. It's not a place for us to spam you. We do pray for those who are gathered with us each and every week. We're thankful for that. So if you let us know you're here, that can go in the offering plate this evening. Or if you do it on the app, that works as well. On the back of that card, perhaps more importantly, is a place for prayer. Even if you're just kind of here for the first time and you're only here tonight, we'd love to join with you in prayer, whatever's going on in your life, good, bad, or who knows. And so if you'd like to have some prayer, someone join you in prayer, I invite you to put your prayer request on the back of here. Also, that can be done online as well. If you'd like that prayer incorporated into our worship service tonight, hang on to that. I will come around during the offering, and you can hand that card to me along with the gift you have for me. I'll take it then, too. Okay? If you don't want prayer in the service tonight, you can just throw it into the offering plate, and we will pray over that at another time as well. So I think that's all the details we need this evening. Let's get this thing on the road. Let's enjoy some time in worship. I invite you to please rise as you are able as we begin with our opening hymn this evening.
Thank you.
The Advent wreath as a circle is meant to remind us of God's promise of everlasting life to us through Christ. The God of hope fills our hearts with hope-filled anticipation, the coming of Jesus. Jesus instills in us a peace that passes all understanding. Make us instruments of your peace and teach us to find joy in the gift of your Son, who came to this world with nothing, yet gave us everything. It is your love which shines like a light to all people, transforming our lives and inspiring us to share that light with others. As we join together in song this evening now, our candles will be lit as we continue to celebrate the approaching Christmas celebration.
Oh,
What we've earned for ourselves is death, which is why we so desperately need Jesus to come to us with life. So we take some time tonight to acknowledge that, even on this Christmas Eve, to come before our God and to confess our sins to Him, that He might indeed forgive us and give us this gift of life. I invite you to join with me as we confess our sins together. Lord Jesus, on this holy night, we remember that You came to earth humbly lying in a manger, to bring Your divine love to our troubled world. You came to die for us so our sin would be forgiven, past, present, and future. This is a gift from You we cannot purchase or find in anyone. Hear us then as we prepare to come to Your table. Lord Jesus, we celebrate the moment You came to save us from our sins through Your love and Your mercy. We thank You, Jesus, for the redemption of sin that only comes through You. You see, Jesus came for you. It all happened just as the angel said, as we'll hear in just a moment. She will give birth to a son, and you are to call Him Jesus, for He will save His people from their sins. So through the blood of Jesus Christ, who brought life into this world, know this tonight, that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The light has come. Amen. And may that light bring light into the most darkest darkness of our lives. Indeed, as Jesus has forgiven us, we have boldness then in approaching Him in prayer. Would you join with me as we come to Him in prayer this evening and pray with me? Heavenly Father, on this holy night, we thank You for the gift of Jesus, our Savior. As we celebrate the joy of His birth, give us faith to welcome Him into our lives. We pray for the peace that only You can give. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We join in song.
our Old Testament text. Now you're awake. The Old Testament text for this Christmas Eve comes from Isaiah chapter 7, a beautiful picture of what God does. Before even Jesus came into this world, before it was even close, he declared what he would do. He gave his promises. Starting at verse 10, again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, the king of the day. Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights. But Ahaz said, I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. We'll call him Emmanuel. This is the word of the Lord. I invite you to please rise as we join together in a brief chorus before the reading of the Holy Gospel. And open our heart tonight to hear it anew and refreshed. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth to Galilee, to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him, and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shined around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared, the angels praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. When the angels had left and gone into heaven, shepherds said to one another, let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told about him, this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary, she treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and all the things that they had seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the good news of our Lord on this Christmas Eve. We join together proclaiming God's goodness as we sing Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Thank you.
proclaim that good news indeed in song, but we also proclaim it in the confession of our faith. Tonight we're going to join together in what we call the Christmas Creed. It's very similar to the Apostles' Creed that we speak each and every Sunday here. Little twist, little turn, keep us on our toes, but to remind us of the special nature of today, I invite you to join with me in confessing these words as you feel comfortable in doing so.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, who sent his Son Jesus into the world as my Savior. I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, announced by the angels, worshipped by shepherds, adored by the wise men. He lived and suffered on my behalf. He then died and rose alive from the grave, freeing me from sin, death, and the power of the devil. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who brought me to faith in Christ at Christmas, and by his continuous work in my heart, I am ever led to lay before the feet of Jesus the treasures of my love. I now celebrate and live under Jesus as my King, in the sure hope that is to come, both now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated. At this time, we take a moment to gather our tithes and our offerings. This is not something that we lay on you as an expectation. If you're visiting with us tonight, this is not something we demand, not something we expect. It's an opportunity for us to return to the Lord a portion of what he's given to us. And so we do so tonight joyfully. If you have a prayer request you want in the service this evening, I invite you to hold those up, and I will be around. Grab my attention. I have snatched that from you during this time. We thank our musicians again, our flutists as well, for playing for us this evening and the blessing they are to us on this Christmas Eve.
No way. for these gifts that have been given tonight. We thank you for the gifts of music, the gift of our lives. Lord, may we use all that we have to glorify you in Jesus' name. Amen.
This evening, as we join together in prayer, I did not get any special requests, but I know that that does not mean there are nothing stirring in our hearts and going on in our families and our lives. So we take time as a church tonight, as a family, as a community, to come before the Lord and lift up prayers of thanksgiving and joy and supplication in need. We'll do that this evening, and as I end each petition, and I will end it with the words, Lord, in your mercy, I invite you, as you so feel comfortable to do, to respond by saying, hear our prayer for Jesus' sake. I invite you to please rise as you are able as we come before you.
God, with the birth of your Son, you reveal that you are love. Give us true faith in Jesus and his promises. Help us to trust that through Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection, our sins are forgiven and we are yours. Fill us with joy so that we may proclaim your glad tidings to all people. Lord, in your mercy, through the birth of Jesus, you came into our world to walk beside those who are struggling in any way, shape, or form. So we lift up those we know who are facing difficulties of every kind. Let your presence comfort them. Give them strength until the time you grant to them healing or relief, deliverance, and even peace. But Lord, we also thank you tonight for the abundance of blessings you provide for us each and every day. We thank you for the ways that our families have come together, for the safe travel for those that are here. We thank you for the joy of finances and gifts and food which come before us in the table this evening and throughout this weekend. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus, by your birth as the Bethlehem baby, you took your place in the family of Mary and Joseph. Bless the families of the church in our country that men and women would live faithfully as husbands and wives, loving and caring for their children, and raising them in the grace of baptism and the truth of your word. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, your Son, born in Bethlehem, is the Son of David and the Lord of David, to whom every knee will bow. Bless those who have placed in positions of authority. Grant that they would lead us with wisdom and justice. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, all these things we bring before your throne of grace, confident that you not only hear our prayers, but Lord, you answer them according to your good and your gracious will. We pray then in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. We join together in a song of joy.
Thank you.
just super pepped by that song. Thought I should get it in the right spirit. God's grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. They say it's the most wonderful time of the year, don't they? I don't have no idea who they is, but that's what they say. And you know what? We spend a lot of time and money and energy and resources going out into our society, out into the world to try to create an atmosphere where it truly feels like the most wonderful time of the year. And there's so many good things, isn't there? Right, we go out or we put on Christmas celebrations, or we go out to Christmas parties, don't we? And we get there and the music is playing and the food is there. I mean, stuff you don't usually eat, but you know it's the holidays, so you might as well eat 15 cookies. There's drinks there that you aren't usually drinking, but you know what, you'll have another glass. There, you even invite people you don't even necessarily like because it's the most wonderful time of the year. And it fills us with this sense of excitement. But not only do we put on celebrations, we also go out and we buy all these decorations and we put on these decorations and we go outside, we dangerously climb ladders to put lights up. And we bring things from the outside like trees and we bring them inside. And then we put lights on the trees. Way better than the candles back in the day. The lights on the trees, and we adorn our homes with all these things that stir memories in you, don't they? You all remember when Grandma gave us this ornament? Oh, so amazing. Oh, remember the stuff? We got this over that one year where we were all deathly sick? But it stirs those kind of memories in us when we put the decorations up. But it brings a little bit of light. We go out, and we even look at them. Into the darkness of the season. We go to pageants and programs, dance recitals. We had a couple programs here at Timothy down at our school. We had a Christmas cantata. Yes, don't screw that one. Christmas cantata last week down at our Wyatt campus as well. All this music. And again, the vibe is there, the feel is there, and then we get emotionally connected to those things. And there's our little grandson or little granddaughter. Yeah, he's got his finger in his nose, but man, he's killing it out there. Oh, it's good. So good. And again, we have that emotional connection. We go out and we buy gifts, and then we put wrapping paper on these gifts, and we take some time to share and to give. And there's that excitement built in that too. Some of you are sitting there going, I can't wait till they open that tonight or tomorrow. It's going to be so good. And then we go out and we go buy our Christmas outfit, right? Maybe it's an ugly Christmas sweater. Don't say this is ugly. You know you're looking on your phone right now to see where I got that. I know. It's cool. All right? But maybe you go out and get your Christmas best and you go and you find it and you purchase it, you buy it, you put it on because you want to look the part too. I mean, all this stuff's going on around you, but you want to feel it too, and you want to be a part of this most wonderful time of the year. So you go out and you buy and you put on. And it's good, isn't it? Anybody like some of this stuff? No, none of you can't say that. Yes, you're in church. No, I don't like, I only like Jesus. Bunch of liars. I gotta share my cookies with you. And it is good, and I hope you enjoy it. I really do. I hope tonight is fun. I hope tomorrow is fun. I hope the week ahead is fun. Especially if you bring a gift for me and put it on the tree for me. But we all know there's a problem with this, don't we? Oh, we may not want to admit it. We may not want to talk about it. We may not want to get into it too much. We may want to just put it off, but it's coming. We know. And you see, here's the problem with all this stuff we go out and all this stuff we put on. Here's the problem. The problem is it's only for a short time. I know we start Christmas in September now. But still, for a short time, right? It's the most wonderful time of the year. It's just a season. It's just a time. And we know that in a few short days, or maybe a week or two, all this stuff is going to go away, isn't it? And what's concerning about that is that when this stuff starts coming off,
and getting put away, the same struggle that we had before is still going to be there. And so the parties are going to end, and we're going to put the snacks away and the food into the cabinet. Well, maybe that's not a good idea. Put it somewhere else, but throw it out. I don't know. We're going to put it away, but guess what's still going to be there? That guilt. That shame that you've been struggling with. That addiction you see in someone you love. Or maybe that addiction that's dark and deep within you. That's still going to be there when the cookies and the parties and the celebrations go away. And when the decorations start coming off and we start packing our boxes with all our Christmas festive stuff and we tuck them in. I don't know how you guys get all that stuff in your garage. Some of you, I would drive by houses, I'm like, they have to have a shed somewhere. There ain't no way that's in our house. Okay? All right, we'll confess that later if that's you. But all that stuff goes away, all the lights, and then guess what still stays, though? Guess what's still with us? The darkness that we've been experiencing because of things that have gone on in our lives. Maybe there's a stirring of depression in you. It's not uncommon for people to struggle with depression in January and February or any time of the year because of things that are happening that are out of their control. And that stuff's still going to be there when the lights and the decorations go away. When the pageants end. And the recitals end. And the emotional connections end. What's still going to be there? The sadness we felt before. The fact that we are tired and worn because we are people running around like crazy to get to this program and this activity and that activity. And we are tired, we are worn, and it doesn't stop. When the gifts, right, when they get unwrapped, and we all know, right, they're going to be used for a while, and then they're going to go in the other pile, and then maybe they'll never be used again, I don't know. But they kind of start fading in the background, and instead of thinking about giving, we're thinking about all the things that have been taken from us in our lives. Our health, our wellness, maybe a loved one who's not here this year that should be. You see, all that stays when this stuff goes away. And then we take our outfits, we take our clothes, and we put them back on the hanger, and we hang them up for another year. And many of us, we can't even wear them next year because, you know, we grow or shrink. And what's left is the feelings of being lost. I don't know where I'm going in life. I don't know what's next for me in life. I don't know what's happening in life. You see, that's the problem with this stuff. We go out, we put on all of this stuff. And we try to cover all this that's going on in us. All of this that has clung to us. The problem is, it's only for a time, it's only for a season, and then it's gone. And so if you're here tonight with me, and you're thinking, you know what, Pastor? I want something more. I want something more than a moment, more than a time, more than a feeling. I want something more. If you're here tonight and maybe that's stirring in you, then guess what? I have good news for you. I'm glad you're here tonight. And you're not thinking that, I'm going to bring you along for the journey anyway. Because I want to offer you something more than this. Because when we gather here in this place tonight, we're not talking about us and what we go out and do. We're talking about God and His story and what He's doing and what He's got going on. And you see, God does things differently than we do, if you didn't notice that. When we're busy going out and putting on, God says, no, 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 I don't need you to do that. I don't need you to go out. I don't need you to put on. Here's instead what needs to happen. I need to come into this. I need to come into your mess and into your suffering and into your addiction and into your lives, and by golly, I'm coming. You stop going, you stop doing, and you let me do what only I can do. We've already been talking about that tonight, if you haven't been paying attention, in our confession and in our hymns. God comes in. And there's no better place to see God coming into our world than seeing it through the Christmas story. Melissa and I have been reading through, and some of you, the rest of you, have been reading through this prayer book, the 25-Day Christmas Prayers, and it's been stirring in me this picture of God's plan of salvation, God's plan of His Word. And it starts with His promises. You see, God starts, and we've been praying and thinking about God's promises. And what are God's promises? All the way back to Adam and Eve, all the way back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to the Israelites, to even in the sense of the disciples in some sense, some way, God made a promise. He said, I am sending a Savior into the world. I am sending someone into your lives, into the mire, into the muck, into the ugly, into the hurt, into the pain. I'm sending a Savior into that. And not only that, but in Isaiah chapter 7, we just read a little bit ago, he says not only is it going to be a Savior, but it's going to be Emmanuel, which means God with us. It's not just going to be anybody coming in. It's going to be me. I'm coming. Watch out, folks. I'm entering into the mess. I'm entering into the fray. I'm entering into the ugly. And that's God's promise. He's been promising that since nearly the creation of the world. He's been promising that since the fall of man. And then we see in the Christmas story, if you listen tonight or you just think about it in just a little bit, you can think about all the ways that God shows himself coming in. And how is he going to come? The question is, how is God going to come into the world? Is he going to come in and blow up the sky and be like, here I am. Better get your act together. Let me fix this. No. What does he do? He comes into our flesh and into our blood to be one with us. The infinite, almighty God says, I'm going to come and I'm going to be like you. And I'm going to know the hurt that you have. And I'm going to know the pain that you have. And I'm going to walk through what you walk through. And he comes into the flesh. And then we hear the crazy story earlier in Advent that not only is he coming in the flesh, but he says, the angel Gabriel comes to Mary and says, hey lady, I got some news for you. You're pregnant by the Holy Spirit. And so this omniscient, omnipresent, powerful God not only comes into the flesh, but he comes into the womb. Can you imagine? If you think about this, this God who could do anything just cramped in the womb. He comes into the womb and he enters into the world, and where do they have to place him? In a manger, because there ain't no room. They wrapped him in cloths, because that's all they had. He comes into poverty. We know Mary and Joseph didn't have a lot. He doesn't come in royalty. He doesn't come in glory. He comes in poverty. And he comes to this little city of Bethlehem. Now, we know that city. We feel good about that city. We write songs about that city. But in those days, it wasn't no big deal. It's like, I'm sorry if I offend anybody here. It's like saying, hey, Jesus is coming to Belton. Okay, Belton's great. Okay, it's amazing if you live there. I'm so glad you live there. But I have yet to meet anybody. Now, I've been here that long. I have yet to meet anybody who has been to Belton. He's going to rock your face off. Nobody has said that to me. And so Bethlehem was kind of that place. And they're like, hey, we had David one time. Yes. Come see the statue. But that's all, right? So Jesus comes into nothing. He comes into poverty. He comes into the flesh. And he comes into a woman's womb. That's how God's going to do this. To be in the middle of it. That's how. And then the question is, what's he going to do? And you see, that's what we see unfold in the Gospels. That's what the Gospels are all about. What is God going to do? And what do we see God do? We see God go into the hurt of people, into the hurting lives of people. Who did Jesus hang out with? Sinners and tax collectors. Okay? These are not the high-class people. These are not the people serving prime rib on Christmas. These are the low class who knew they were low, who were rejected by society, rejected by even perhaps their families for what they had done. They thought there was no way out. They can't do anything. They're stuck in this. And that's where Jesus goes. I ain't going to go like that. I don't walk around Bruce Ray's going, well, where's the shadiest stuff going on? That sounds like a good place for me to go. But that's what Jesus does. He goes into it. Into the hurt. You know what else he goes? He goes into the darkness. To those suffering from demonic possession we see in the Gospels, from those suffering from feeling lost and without a shepherd, to those who are going through difficult and dark times. That's where Jesus goes. He goes into that darkness and he says, hey, here I am. That's not where I go. I don't even go to the basement without turning the light on. Any kids give me an amen? No. Okay, it's just me. It's fine. It's all right. The guy wearing the t-shirt. Yeah, okay. Where else does Jesus go? He goes into places where there's disease and sickness and illness. I remember a handful of years ago when the Ebola virus was going on in Africa, And I remember a story about the people from Samaritan's Purse. There was a handful of them, maybe a little more than a handful, who went over in order to care for people with Ebola because they didn't know how to resolve the issue. They had to clean and put on all this layer over layer over layer. And then they would tend to these people who were sick. They had to come out and they had to clean themselves over and over and over. And even despite some of that, some of them got sick. And I'm thinking, I don't know if that's for me. I mean, that may sound, make me sound like a horrible human being, and that's okay. I am a sinner, just so you know. But that's not the place I'm necessarily all about going. That's the place Jesus goes. He goes into the lives of the sick and the ill, and even those who had leprosy, which is kind of like that, where you don't touch those people. And Jesus says, oh, yes, I do. I'm coming into it. That's where Jesus goes. And even into the darkest place that we know, the place that wounds our hearts and has impacted each of our lives, Jesus goes into the darkness of the tomb. And the stone is rolled, and there Jesus is laid, and he is dead because he suffers on a cross innocently and dies for each of us, placed in. None of us sitting here going, man, I can't wait for that day. Man, I hope I get a nice headstone. But that's where Jesus goes. He goes into the ugly and into the dark and into the suffering. That's where he goes. But he doesn't just go there. He goes there to change everything. He goes there to change absolutely, positively everything. And so to the lives of those who are hurting, you know what he brings? Freedom and forgiveness. You are forgiven. You are loved. You are freed from the lies. You are freed from the destruction. You are freed from what other people think of you. And you know what? You're okay with Jesus. You're okay with me. You're okay with God because I'm going to give my life in exchange for you. That's freedom to the hurting. He goes into the darkness, and what does he do? He brings light. Scripture tells us in the book of John, it says, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. Whoever comes to me is never going to be in darkness. And so Jesus says, hey, you're feeling like you're in darkness. You're feeling lost, but I am here, and you stick with me, and you ain't going to be in darkness anymore. He goes to the disease and the suffering, and he brings healing to them, and he brings hope to them in what he's doing. He goes into the tomb, and he says, nah, this ain't the end. And he walks out 3 days later, resurrected. He walks into death, and he comes out with life. You see, Jesus changes everything. And we need to know that tonight. You need to know that tonight. I need to know that tonight, because God is not done. God is not done doing this. You see, we worship a God who is Emmanuel. That's God with us. Not God was once with us, but now he's gone. That's the worst Christmas card ever. Okay, don't buy that one. It's probably on sale somewhere. Hobby Lobby's going to sell that one. Discount prices. God with us. Not was with us, is with us. So just like he was 2,000 years ago, born into this world, he's here with us today. He was here when we started our worship. He was here when we confessed our sins. He was here when we sung the hymns. He was here when we read the scriptures. He's here as we dive into this together. He's here. And he's got things to do. Because he's here for you. God is with us, and he comes with him. And what comes with him, I'm sorry, are gifts. He brings gifts. Oh, good news. Okay, kids are back with me now. He comes with gifts, all right? We've got gifts. And the two gifts we have from Jesus we heard, ooh, there we go again. We heard in the gospel lesson. Okay, I'm a little hyped up tonight. I have not had any cookies, I swear. All right? Jesus is just good, okay? So we're just going to ride this out, and you can talk about that crazy guy later, okay? Two things that Jesus brought with him 2,000 years ago. The angels declared, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that for great joy. When Jesus comes, he brings joy. All right, angels have something else to say. Okay? Glory to God, they're singing. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those whom his favor rests. Right? Jesus brings with him joy and peace. Everybody say joy.
Joy.
Everybody say peace.
Peace.
You say that up there. They're okay, they gave me a thumbs up. Okay, they're up there. Right? Joy, and we've got peace. We've got these two things. Now, I want you to think about those two things, joy and peace. Those are things we're all longing for in some way, shape, or form. We may call it something else, but we want it. I want that. These are not things you can get at Costco. You can get anything at Costco almost. Okay? There was a couple out in California. Where did you guys meet? We met at Costco. I was like, what? Didn't know they had that. But they do. Okay? So guys, if you're single and you know, this week's the week. It's a busy week at Costco, okay? Don't take my advice. Okay. But you can't get it at Costco, and you know what? You can't get it in Amazon. I searched for peas on Amazon. I found a whole bunch of hippy-dippy stuff, okay? And then, like, little plaques and all kinds of things like that. But there was no, hey, come out, buy this, put it on, you got it. You know that? Joy and peace don't work that way. You can buy lights, you can buy cookies, you can throw celebrations, you can put on sweaters that are beautiful and amazing. But you can't buy and go get and put on joy and peace. That starts inside. And the good news is that's where Jesus comes. He comes into the world. He comes into the womb of a woman. He comes into Bethlehem. He comes into poverty. And he comes into your brokenness. He comes into your pain. He comes into your suffering. He comes into your life. He invades into your life. And he is here, church. He is here to bring you joy and peace. And so in the midst of your guilt and your suffering, guess what? There's joy and there's peace in Christ Jesus. Joy, because we know it's temporary. It's temporary. Jesus is here. And so my grief my shame has been wiped clean through the blood of the cross. And there's peace in knowing I am reconciled with God. The Bible tells us that all over. We are reconciled to God because of Jesus. We heard that in absolution today. Right? Like, that's legit. I know that just sounds like words. Oh, that guy's just talking about forgiveness. No, no, that's like what God does. That's joy and peace. He comes into your tired and worn lives, and he brings with you him a promise. In the book of Hebrews, he tells us, I have a rest for you that is eternal. A rest that is powerful. A rest where you're just going to be with me. You're going to do your thing and you're going to worship. But you ain't going to struggle. You ain't going to be tired. You ain't going to be running around like a maniac. You're simply going to rest in the joy of God saving. He says, come to me, all you are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. In the midst of our loss and the wounds that we have, Jesus brings with him joy and peace. In the midst of our depression, he brings joy and peace. Joy to say, this is not going to be forever. The psalmist says that sorrow comes in the night. But guess what? Joy comes in the morning. That's another way of saying sorrow lasts for a time and a season and a moment. Like all the outside stuff we're buying and putting on. But what lasts eternally is joy. And so we have that. And there's peace in knowing that God has defeated even the darkest stuff like death. And that he offers to us life. He comes with life. Jesus comes with joy and he comes with peace for you tonight. Whatever's going on in your life, whatever resonates with you from this shirt, or whatever's stirring in your mind, Jesus is here tonight with joy and peace. And not a joy and peace that flees, but a joy and peace that's going to last when the decorations go away and I eat all of these. So if you're wanting more tonight, if you're looking for more than this and that and this and that, Jesus is the answer. That sounds really simple. But Christmas is really simple. God came into the world for you and for me to give hope, to give peace, to give joy, to give life. To bring light into the darkness. So the only question there is to ask tonight is this. Where are you going to look for it? Are you going to look for it going out into the world, doing what you can, getting what you can, putting on what you can? Or are you going to look to the one who's already brought the good news, who's already brought the heat, who's already given his life and resurrected and holds it out? Where's it going to be? Let me pray for you tonight. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this time together. Lord, we thank you for all the amazing things in this season that we get to celebrate, and cookies and parties and outfits and pageants. And there is so many things we cling to that feel so good. But Lord, the truth is under all of it, all the stuff we put on and all the stuff we go out to, under it all, Lord, there is hurt and there is pain because we're living in a broken world where there is divorce and sickness and illness. There's animosity between friends. There's hostility. There's violence. There's murder. There's war. There's infidelity. There's addictions. Lord, all of this stuff is just a reality in every single one of us. has to cope with that, has to navigate that, Lord, and is marred and scarred by that. But you came into it. God, you came into it to do something different, to tell a different story, to tell a story of hope and life and joy and peace. And that story is not just your story. It's a story that you draw us into, that you welcome us into, because we are called to be children of God, to be set free. Lord, we want to be set free. For those that are sitting there going, yes, Lord, I want something more. Lord, set us free. Give us the forgiveness we need. Bring to the table joy and peace so that we've got something that doesn't just last us a few more days or a few more hours, but that carries us through the next month, the next year, the rest of our lives, being certain and confident that while we may grieve in this world, we don't grieve without hope because you've got something for us. And it's eternal. And so we set our eyes on that this Christmas Eve. And may the Spirit of God drive us into a deeper understanding and confession of that as we grow in you and hunger for more of you and what you have. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks for spending some time with us this evening. I want you to receive the blessing of the Lord. He's got something else for you. These are words that we say in a traditional Lutheran setting. We say it in all the places, but we don't just say them because we say them. We say them because Jesus said in the Old Testament, in the book of Numbers chapter 6, he said to the pastor, the priest, they call him in those days, he said, speak this blessing over my people. So here's the blessing God has for you tonight. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace now and forever. Amen. Amen. At this time, I'm going to invite you to grab your candles. And it's that time. Right? Thank goodness. He's done. Let's go. Light these puppies up. Okay, there's a couple of rules. Go ahead and stand. I invite you to please stand as you are able. Okay, we have this disclaimer. We need you all to sign the waiver under your seat. So please reach under there, grab that. Okay. I'm just kidding. All right, in just a moment, I'm going to grab my candle. And from the Christ candle, the light of the world is the imagery here. I'm going to bring my candle down to our ushers and our elders, and they're going to come by and light the ends of each row so you can have light too. Okay, and we're going to light this place up with our own candles. But here's the scoop. If you're getting your candle lit, all right, if you're lighting your candle, you can turn it sideways like this, okay? If yours is already lit, please hold it like this, unless you'd like to hang out with me later and clean, okay? I would love to spend some time with you, but not that way. So if yours is already lit, please hold it up like this. If you're getting it lit, then you put yours over to the side like that. That prevents a lot of issues. And then when you blow it out, make sure the person in front of you, make sure your hand's there, because the person in front of you does not need wax in their hair. And we want to go out in joy and peace, not hostility and animosity. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to our musicians, invite our elders and ushers up, and we're going to light the candles this evening and worship our Lord inside of them.
Thank you.
God's blessings upon you as you go out for safety, for joy and peace to belong to you through Christ. As you blow your candle out tonight, again, I invite you to put your hand in front of it and blow gently. If you have kiddos, help them out. Colton, I'm watching you. No fire respect, buddy. And may you go out and joy and peace. God's blessings.